Hey, I'm Dave. Welcome to my shop. I'm Dave Plummer, a retired operating systems engineer from Microsoft, going back to the MS-DOS and Windows 95 days, and today, it's the classic confrontation, Windows versus Linux. Now, don't let the fact that I was one of the programmers that actually wrote Windows fool you into thinking I would ever dare to be anything but fair and objective. I absolutely guarantee that everything you hear from me today will be completely unbiased.
No guarantee.
We'll also discuss the possibility of an open source Windows kernel, and I'll tell you whether I think that's a good idea or not, and you might be surprised. Right now, it's round one in our epic operating systems face-off. What? Am I joking? One of the Windows developers is going to riff on Linux and tell you why it's lame? Some ill-informed diatribe on how easy to use Windows is and how you have to recompile the Linux kernel in order to change your page margins, perhaps? Not at all. I'll let you in on a little secret. Like a lot of people, I experimented a bit back in college. And way, way back in my Commodore 64 days, I knew a guy that had an honest-to-goodness PDP-11 in his dining room. He'd bought a surplus from the phone company, and I had some serious Unix envy ever since I first saw it. I started college in 1989, and I began using Linux, which was first released in 91, sometime around third year, which means I've been a Linux user pretty much since the very beginning. And that was back when merely installing and booting the thing made you the stuff of legend. Not only that, I fixed a few handle leaks in the early source code and sent my changes off to Linus at Rutgers, so it's quite possible that if he did incorporate them, then I have code not only in Windows and Mac Office, but also within Linux, making me pretty much inescapable. No matter where you go, you're living the Dave PL life. Well, enough of my vainglorious boasting for now. Let's start talking about operating systems. I always figure that context matters, and in this case, the context here is that it's you and me talking. If the question is which operating system is better for grandma, unless your grandma is Margaret Hamilton, then perhaps odds are that she will be best served by the polished user interface, feature richness, and application library available for Windows. Conversely, for a database or web server, you'd be a fool not to at least look at a Linux distro. But even if one operating system were a whopping 10% faster than the other, that's simply not the greatest concern for every individual. Neither are the final few nines in five nines reliability, at least not in the consumer space like that. So the context I'm talking about then is for folks like us. I'm a programmer and you do whatever it is you do, but odds are it's something in a technical capacity. Chances are that you're an early adopter and a bit of an evangelist for whatever technologies tickle your fancy. Friends and even sometimes strangers rely on you for advice on not only what products to buy, but also on how to use them once they've finally got them. You might just be the kind of person that's on technical support for your doctor's office, during an appointment, on the x-ray machine, maybe some light repair work on it. I know I've done it. To people like you and me then, a 10% performance hit might be material. On a box running huge RAID arrays, the interval between crashes has to be enormous because the rebuild times are also incredibly long. It all depends on what you're doing, and the odds are that folks such as us are using our machines for more demanding tasks than the average consumer. In our case, it's valid to split hairs on things like performance and robustness. The one thing you can't do though is to just spout generalities as facts. You can't say Linux crashes less because you heard it in a chat room. You can't even say one is absolutely more secure than the other, really, but you can certainly make a case for one over the other, and you can bet I will. Back in the 90s when we were working on NT, I was wandering around the hallway on a Saturday afternoon, and I happened to walk by the offices of one of the original engineers who had come over from working on VMS at Digital Equipment with Dave Cutler. I asked him a simple question. VMS was perhaps the most solid operating system ever known, at least back in its day, and since those very same VMS designers and developers were now working on Windows NT, why would it be any less reliable? Should it be getting smarter and better with each attempt at creating a new operating system? His answer, at least as I recall it today, was that on reference hardware, it likely is as solid, if not more so. But in real life, people run it on all kinds of different hardware, and it's that endless matrix of systems and BIOSes and chipsets and drivers that makes it challenging. VMS ran on a handful of hardware configurations at most. macOS runs on maybe half a dozen. Windows has to support millions of different configurations. It doesn't explain everything, but it is a valid point. You can't test them all, and so the user is often the first person to test that particular configuration, particularly in terms of peripherals and drivers and applications, only to find some kind of weird edge case. We'll get to benchmarks and feature comparisons and so on, but we're going to begin with the biggest and most obvious difference between the two systems. It's open source versus proprietary. It's round one in the epic Linux versus Windows showdown. No quarter given, none asked. Linux is, and always has been, open source. Well, the central authority, which I presume is still ultimately Linus himself, can decide whether or not to accept the change. Anybody can contribute. If the Japanese Yakuza needs a feature to help facilitate their legitimate business interests, they can simply add it. No need to lobby the manufacturer of the software, and they can design and implement the feature exactly as they see fit. As long as it's plausibly useful to other people and well done, there's no reason the change wouldn't be accepted. And if you can't get your change into the official kernel, nothing stops you from simply running your own kernel or even making your own Linux distribution entirely. And that's just not the case with Windows, of course. If you need a feature that for some reason needs to be in the operating system, you're going to have to lobby pretty hard in order to have a very compelling case for why Microsoft should invest in dev, test, and other resources to your Yakuza needs. Even if you can somehow convince the right decision makers, it would take much longer for Microsoft to design, implement, test, and release the feature than it would for you to make the change in an open source product yourself. So for flexibility of customization, there's no question. Linux wins that one, hands down. Now, before you Linux nerds get too excited about scoring that first big point, however, there's one question you've got to ask yourself, and that's just how common is it to need to modify the operating system in a way that cannot be done by a software developer on Windows by writing an application, driver, DLL, or similar? Since Windows allows you to dynamically load and unload even kernel code on the fly, there's not a lot you can't do without a copy of Visual C++ and a little knowledge. But there are cases where it matters. Let's say you're working on developing something like the ZFS file system. I imagine that being able to see and even modify the code to the I/O subsystem and the cache manager is hugely valuable. But for the average developer, and especially the average user, being able to hack on the kernel just isn't something you need to do all that often. When I was working on certain Windows features, it was super handy for me to be able to look at operating system API source code. You have no idea how valuable it can be when a complex API like create window fails to be able to step through the source code or even source level debug the API code itself and see exactly why it's failing. Without the source code, it's far more difficult. Having had that privilege, it's something I can truly appreciate, and it's something that Linux gives to developers that Windows, by its closed nature, simply cannot. I was a bit of a rebel in my early years at Microsoft in that I preferred a visual debugger, like the one included with the VC development environment, over the internal one, such as our NTSD debugger. You had to know it anyway, because remote debugging was always still done in it, but for local use on your own machine, it meant that you could build the system with Visual C-style symbols and then debug those portions with VC. One downside is that the resultant binaries are fairly enormous. You're only going to have such symbols for components that you compile yourself, but in those cases, it allows you to source-level debug and single-step through the source code, whereas 99% of my other debugging had to be done in assembly language. One day, when I was working on the Ole RPC team, I was debugging a fairly complicated rendering and printing case that involved Microsoft Word. To make my life easier, I convinced someone on the Word team to share the source code out, and I compiled and built the entire Microsoft Word product for my own complete use with the Visual C symbols. I was then able to load up Word under the debugger and step through the source code all day long. It made debugging just that much more pleasant, except for the fact that I was probably doing it on a machine with like 12 megabytes of RAM, and I think the binary image for Word with symbols was about three times that size. It was paging pretty hard. Back to the point, however, it's not always true, but sometimes the source code is the best type of documentation, and with Linux, it's freely available to all developers. If you're a developer working on one of these operating systems, there are two main resources that you're going to rely on: searching the internet in places like Stack Exchange and the official documentation. When it comes to official documentation, once you've spent any time using MSDN and the official samples, you realize pretty quickly that it makes a huge difference that Microsoft employs teams of professional developers and authors to create that content. It's a huge and valuable resource, and one that doesn't have an official parallel in the Linux universe. Man pages only go so far. Combine that with the fact that you can, if your budget allows, get paid developer support right from Microsoft means at this point goes to Windows. What about the community, though? These days, if you can't find the answer by searching, odds are you may resort to posting your question on a site like Stack Exchange. You are then at the mercy of the quality and the size of the attended audience for your operating system of choice. To find out if there was actually a difference, I compared the size of the communities and their activity levels on Stack Exchange. The top questions of the month for Unix and Linux receive, on average, 5 good answers, 25 upvotes, and about 2,500 user views. The Windows developer site, by contrast, features topics that average 10 useful answers, 50 votes, and about 10,000 views. There are simply more eyeballs looking at Windows installations, and it appears true for the number of experts available to answer questions online as well. The size of the Windows development community is much, much larger and apparently more responsive to developer questions. You probably think I'm cleverly staggering these topics to maintain a virtual tie between the operating systems all throughout until the episode end where I get to some lame draw. The honest truth is I'm not. I'm working my way through a set of topics I produced and wrote down in advance and letting the chips fall where they may. And I don't know the final score yet because I haven't answered them all yet. The next category of consideration is usability. Linux itself lacks a proper user interface beyond the command line. That command line can be incredibly powerful, particularly if you're adept with Bash or ZSH or similar, but it can't really be described as particularly usable. Of course, most distributions do come with a desktop user interface of some kind if you prefer, but as a bit of a shell designer myself, if I might be so bold, they're generally pretty terrible. At least the Mint distribution looks pretty nice. Windows, on the other hand, includes by default a desktop shell interface that, if you set aside the entirely subjective design aesthetics, is professionally designed, usability tested, and takes into consideration the varying levels of accessibility required by people with different limitations. In terms of usability, particularly if you do include accessibility in that metric, Windows comes out ahead. One argument I hear put forth by various proponents of the open source model is that open source software is generally developed by people who actually use the software, and therefore, it is assumed that they are thus more familiar with the software and perhaps even more passionate about it. While I'm not even sure I'm ready to concede those points, I can render them moot by pointing out that Windows developers eat their own dog food daily, by which I mean a developer writing for the Windows operating system works on and operates within that operating system all day long. As a Windows developer at Microsoft, you're always running a fairly recent daily build on your main machine. You write Windows on Windows from within Windows, just as you likely would with Linux. So in the rather unique case of the operating system, it doesn't really offer a benefit in either direction, and so for this one, I'm going to call this a draw. When it comes to updating an operating system, it can range from a silent update that happens in the background, of which you were never even aware, all the way to a complex upgrade where Apple switches CPUs yet again. Each operating system has its own philosophy on how to handle upgrades, and those attitudes are reflected in one of my favorite cartoons by Christian McCauley. It compares the views of Linux, Windows, and Mac users when it comes to upgrades. Linux users. Aw, cool, man, more free stuff. Windows users. Oh man, more Windows updates, not again. Mac user. Ooh, only $99. On the far end of the update spectrum is the Mac, where Apple has the cojones to simply require all the users on the applications to update when they make a breaking change, and probably charge you for that privilege. Windows users are well served by a dedicated Windows Update team at Microsoft, but the process has occasionally had its hiccups and growing pains. It's very easy to update a Linux system, and while there's no professional team sitting by the big red phone ready to respond to day zero exploits, the updates do come out with reasonable alacrity, and in some cases, you can even update the kernel without rebooting. Keep in mind, however, that Linux is a monolithic kernel, which means that it's all one big happy kernel. Almost everything is in there. If they hadn't started to add that ability a few years back, you'd be rebooting for every driver install. The reality is that some parts of the Linux kernel are just going to require a reboot, just as some parts of the Windows system are going to as well. I think we can likely all agree, however, that Windows software is hardly selective about rebooting the system, and you're asked to do it far too often. While we're on the topic of upgrades, we can't overlook the fact that upgrades are generally free in the open source world unless you're using a pre-built distribution from a vendor of some kind. To its credit, though, I don't remember last time Microsoft actually charged for an operating system upgrade if you were just a normal end user or enthusiast. Still, this point goes to Linux. The topic of security is going to be a bit contentious, and many of you may not like my answer on it, but I'm not alone in arguing that open source software is more vulnerable to security exploits than closed software simply because, all else equal, it's easier to figure out where the bugs are to exploit in the first place. On the plus side, it does mean that many public experts can also openly review the software and try to catch and fix vulnerabilities before they're exploited. That essentially makes it a race between the black hats and the white hats as soon as the source code is made available. Believe it or not, by nature, proprietary software is less prone to security problems, not only because of the closed nature protects them from being discovered, but also because there's usually a professional test organization whose job it is to find such issues before they enter the product. I think it's a bit of a fallacy to rely on the many eyeballs approach, which simply assumes that because more people can see the code, more bugs will get fixed. While it might be true of buffer overruns and other simple bugs, complex interactions such as security holes, race conditions, and deadlocks may be subtle and far more likely to be caught by a proper test gauntlet than by widespread scrutiny of many casual programmers. What really matters is the careful scrutiny of the right people. And yet, as much as it pains me, and as much as I believe that it is in spite of and not thanks to the open source model, I think that by and large Unix is more secure against the typical digital vandalism for one simple reason. The target value of Windows is so much higher. Unless you're a nation-state specifically targeting someone on Linux, it's generally much more attractive to virus authors to target Windows users simply because there are so many more of them. Even if I were to say that the systems were equally secure, there's one major problem, not with Windows itself, but with how it's typically used. Most users still run as a full administrator, which means as soon as they accidentally click on the wrong user account control pop-up, mayhem can ensue. As your Windows apologist for the day, I should point out that this mess really stems from applications that demand they need to be run as administrator, or which fail to operate properly when run on a limited account. On Linux, it's pretty much an exception when an application needs administrative rights, and for the most part, it doesn't happen unless you explicitly use the sudo command. This means you do it intentionally, not reflexively, and to me, that's the critical difference. Windows isn't alone. You get a similar pop-up on macOS, and it's just as easy to grow similarly jaded to the point that you simply click OK every time you're asked. But I sure don't bust out sudo every time I get an access denied response. I at least stop to think about why the access was denied. Even though massive popularity is a target and misuse of the administrator account isn't really the fault of the operating system itself, that's the reality. And so, the final point in round one goes to Linux. I'm actually a little surprised, as I wasn't sure how this one would shake out myself. Suffice to say, however, it's only round one and there are many more to come. Make sure you're subscribed so you don't miss any future showdowns. Now it's time for some trademark Dave PL opinion, where I get on my little soapbox and tell you what I think. And what do I think? I think Microsoft should consider open sourcing the core Windows kernel, but under a hybrid model. The model I envision involves openly releasing the code to public scrutiny while retaining all of the rights to the software and preventing unauthorized modifications. I personally would love to see such a model adopted for core portions of Windows, such as the kernel and drivers. Make the code available such that anyone can download and even build core components like ntdll and win32k.sys. Bugs can be reported to Microsoft, and if it were me, I'd even pay a bounty. Perhaps the bounty could be on a sliding scale, such that discovering a zero-day privilege escalation attack paid rather handsomely, while a spelling error in a resource file might get you a free copy of Windows and a nice t-shirt. I would also argue for a staged release. Academics and trusted security researchers would be given priority access so that they had ample time to review the code before it was opened up to the broader public. I'm not advocating for an open source modification model where people can commit changes into the kernel, add features or any of that, but I think there's some additive value in the additional scrutiny the code would receive if it were made available to more developers in this way. This would of course work best if done hand in hand with some form of trusted computing module such that the custom kernels which are not officially signed by Microsoft are plainly detected and optionally blocked. If you enjoyed round one but you're not yet subscribed to my channel, I'd be honored if you took a moment to do so right now. That'll also let me know that I'm going in the right direction with this episode. I'll make more like it, and if you turn on the bell icon, you'll even be notified of them when I do. It's a win-win. As always, remember, I'm not selling anything, and I don't have any Patreons. I'm just in this for the subs and likes. So if you did enjoy the episode, please be sure to leave me one of each before going. YouTube really does apparently care if you like the video or not. They call it engagement. Thanks for joining me here in the shop. In the meantime and in between time, I hope to see you next time, right here in Dave's Garage.
This little chair will be waiting for one of you, and a rocking chair for another who likes to rock, and a big armchair for two more to curl up in. All next time on Dave's Garage.